Let's open it in a quick word of prayer, and then we'll jump right into our big idea tonight. Jesus, we thank you that we can be here, and we thank you that we can read in your word. We thank you that we can ponder your ideas and that your Holy Spirit would inspire each and every one of us to see your truth more clearly tonight. God, I pray that as we talk about what it looks like to be connected to you, you would give us a clear vision of what that looks like in our life. We could see it. We could actually visualize it. What does it look like to be connected to you more closely? And in what areas of our life can we connect with you more clearly? God, I pray that you would make this super clear to us. And we pray this together in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, I got to start off. I got to introduce my family. I know I've met many of you. Some of you I haven't met. But for those of you whom have not met me before, I'm Brent Colby, as Lauren said. I work with our network here. And if you're unfamiliar, when you hear people, what is this network they keep talking about? Okay, Northwest Ministry Network is about 330 churches in Washington and Northern Idaho. And the network exists to support those churches in the ministry that they're doing. When I started working there a few years ago, I asked for a job description, and they literally said, well, we just wrote it on the wall. If you walk into the network office, on the wall, it says strengthening and developing empowered leaders in churches. And to this day, that's the only job description I have. I am to strengthen and develop empowered leaders in churches. My job is to serve you, and the role of our network is to support you and help you fulfill the call of God that has been placed on your life wherever you're at, doing whatever you're doing. That's the role of the network. So that's what I get to do. And my wife, Bria, is right there. In fact, I have a picture of our whole family. You can check us out right there. Here's us right there. Oh, there's some cuties there. Okay, so let's see. Our far left, that's Adelaide. Adelaide is 6 years old, and she is adorable, mainly because she is like a little version of my wife, Bria. They are the same person. There's big Bria. Well, not. Okay, there's cute, petite, tall Bria. Okay, tall Bria, that's better. There's tall Bria. Don't ever call your wife big. Don't do that. There's tall Bria and there's short Bria. I'm married to tall Bria. My daughter is little short Bria. So Adelaide is precious. She is adorable and she's often a kitty. So if you ever run into her, she's in that phase where she wants to play cats. She just becomes a cat, okay? So that's where she's at. It's cute and a little strange, but hopefully it's a phase. So that's Adelaide. My lovely wife, Bria, sitting right down there with us. She is a nurse at the University of Washington down in Seattle. She works with little babies that are about this big, and I don't know how she does it. She's amazing. So we've been married for 11 years now, 11 plus years. So that's been awesome. In the middle is Oliver. Oliver is my little buddy. He is 4 years old, and he has no filter. In fact, he doesn't even know how to tell a lie. It's great. So when there's cookies on the counter and he shouldn't be eating them, and he walks into the room, like clearly has eaten a cookie, if you ask Adelaide, did you eat a cookie? No. Like she has like chocolate chips on her face. No. Like, Oliver, son, did you eat a cookie? Yep, I ate two. Right? That's how he... Oliver, go clean your room. He runs around and he comes back a few minutes later. Buddy, did you clean your room? Nope, I just shoved everything under the bed. Okay, son, go clean your room. Okay, dad, he comes back. Did you clean your room? Nope, I just played with my toys. Son, stop. Like, he doesn't even try. He doesn't even try. It's great. He has, like, the idea that he could deceive us has not yet occurred to him. So he's so much fun. So that's Oliver. And then, of course, on the far right is Owen. Owen is two. And he is cute as he is ornery. So he's very cute and he's very ornery. What he wants to do, he will do. He just started getting out of his bed. So I don't know if you've ever been a parent of a toddler before. There's a point at which in the morning they can get out of their bed and open their door. Well, Owen has the house to himself at like 5, 6 in the morning. He's just doing what he wants to do. We hear him shooting basketball hoops in our kitchen. He's in there trying to climb on the counter and get into stuff. He's waking everybody up. He's walking in demanding breakfast cereal. Like, I mean, I appreciate that, but he is such a handful right now, and he is really fun. He's quite the basketball pro. So anyways, that's our family, and we announced a few weeks ago we are expecting baby number 4 to be here in just a few months. So that is awesome. I know you look surprised. I was surprised too. But hey, it's what happens. So that will be our growing family. This time next year, we will be one more. So anyways, thank you guys for supporting us and being a part of Fusion this year. So here's a question for you. What does connection with Jesus look like? And here's our big idea. Connection with Jesus results in a life of worship. And we're going to pivot off of that concept of worship. But connecting with Jesus, it looks like something. And we work really hard about Jesus a lot, right? Our ministries are all about Jesus. Our events are about Jesus. Our churches are about Jesus. Our lives, our schedules, all. Well, a lot of what we do is about Jesus. But what does it look like when we do life with Jesus? And is there a difference between the two? And today I would like to say that there is. And that we need to, in order to be connected with Jesus, we need to learn how to do ministry, how to do life, how to do those things with Jesus as an act of worship, instead of treading on what I think is thin ice and a bit dangerous for us to be doing a bunch of ministry about Jesus. Last summer, I decided to build a shed. Now, when you think of guys building sheds, you think of people who know what they're doing and have tool belts and tools and these sorts of things. This was not me. I just thought a shed is a good idea, so I got out a piece of paper and a crayon, and I drew a shed. Here's how I drew it. I was like, wall, roof. I'm like, hold on, there's some door. Done. Shed. I'm going to build this shed. So I held, these were my blueprints. I don't know if the crayon I used was blue or not. That would have been smart. But I just drew a shed. I only drew it from the front because that's the only part I had envisioned quite yet. From the side, it looked very easy. It was just a square. And that was it. That's what the side of my shed looked like, was a square. The back and the other side were identical, so I had that done. So I had a very clear blueprint of what I wanted. I wanted a building with a roof on it and a door in the front, maybe a window. The part of the visualization you couldn't see was that I was assuming there would be a floor on the bottom. And so I set out to build this shed. Now, being not a particularly experienced carpenter, I knew somebody who was. And this person was my father-in-law, Bob. And I called him and I said, Bob, I'm considering building a shed in my backyard, like a little shed office is what I'm using it for. The shoffice is what we like to call it. I'm building a shoffice. And he said, what is a shoffice? I explained, it's part shed, part office. And he said, I'm in. And so I said, good. I said, I don't know when I can build it. I need to get supplies. My blueprint is a little thin right now, so I need to work on that. And he said, that's great. So Bob called me like 2 weeks later. He goes, Brent, when are we building the shed? When are we building the office, the shoffice? When are we building it? I said, well, I don't know yet. I'm still collecting supplies. I'm doing some stuff. It's kind of a busy season. Like graduation is coming up. It's the end of the school year. This is the beginning of the summer, end of the school year last year. And so then I'm like, well, not yet, but I really want to do it. Okay. And I've been talking about, how long did I talk about the shoffice? For years. I've always wanted this in my backyard. So then, next time, Bob calls me, Brent, I'm coming over next weekend. I'm like, you're coming over? Yeah, we're going to build the shoffice. He's been collecting supplies and tools and every night, and then he lives for this sort of stuff. He wants to build the shoffice. And so I talked to Bria. I'm like, all right, let's clear time in the schedule. It's time. No longer will I hesitate. We are building the shoffice. I took my crayon picture of the shoffice. I put it up on the wall, and I looked at it. I'm like, that's a pretty good plan. Square triangle, rectangle for the door, and we're good to go, right? What could possibly go wrong? Well, Bob's driving over from Spokane, and I realize I need to educate myself. And so where do you go when you need to learn how to do something that you don't really want to spend that much time on? YouTube. Yeah, YouTube. How to build a shed. Oh, man. I got very, very well acquainted with how to build a shed videos on YouTube. Now, if you start following one guy's how to build a shed video and it got hard, I'm like, oh, that sounds difficult. Let's see how somebody else does it. Then I just started following someone else's plan. That's easier. Let's do that. So I was putting together my own how to build. I should build a playlist for you. It's great. So I used that guy's foundations. I did this guy's wall. There's a Canadian guy whose accent was hilarious, so I liked his videos the best. So I used his for the roof. And so I was just slapping this together. And Bob's like, well, how high are the walls? And I'm like, I don't know. How tall is a 2x4? He's like, well, they're 8 feet. The wall will be 8 feet high. It's okay. How big is the floor? I'm like, well, we're working with 8 feet, right? And he's like, yeah. So I'm like, let's go 8 feet by 8 feet. How's that sound? He goes, that's fine. So I built myself what is essentially a jail cell in the back of my yard. It's 8 by 8 by 8 feet tall. And that's it, because that required the least amount of cutting, you know. I'll skip ahead. We did finish it, and the backyard is kind of up on a hill, and it's just slightly slanted, so we did like a foundation, so it's sticking out a little bit, and my neighbor saw it when it was done, and he looks at it, and he goes, so, is that thing like two stories or like what did you do? Because it looks, it just stands straight up in the air. Because on top of the 8-foot tall wall, I didn't realize you had to put a roof on the thing, right? Well, that sticks up like another 3 feet. So this, I have like this like monolith in my backyard just sticking straight up in the air with this door. I had no idea. It looks so dorky, but it's great. So we start building it. And as me and Bob were just going to the, you know, you go to, if you've done a project like this, you go to Home Depot, like, you become familiar with these individuals on a first name basis, right? So, and I have no tools. I don't know what I'm doing, right? Bob threw his garage into the back of his truck, drove it over to our house in Bothell, and we just had a pile of 2x4s and plywood, and we just went to work, which is the best way to learn. That in my YouTube video. So Bob actually had done roofing and carpentry and all sorts of stuff. And the whole time I'm working with Bob, I'm thinking of this because my family's Norwegian, Bria's family's Norwegian. I think of this great story of the two Norwegian guys who are building a house. Have you heard this one? If you hear Norwegian jokes, it's always Sven and Ole. And Sven was on the one side of the house handing Ole nails. And every few nails, you know, the other guy was pounding it. Here's a nail, pound it in. Here's a nail, pound it in. Every few nails, he would take the nail, look at it, and throw it out. And he'd hand him a nail, pound it, and he'd look at a nail, nope, he'd throw it out. And Ole kept asking Sven, why are you throwing those nails out? And Sven would say, well, it's because they're backwards. The head is on the wrong side of the nail. And Ole went, Sven, you idiot. We can use those on the other side of the house, right? So I felt quite often like we were Sven and Ole trying to build this thing. And here's a pattern that happened over and over again. Bob would say, so Brent, what do you want to do? And he's very much like, he's like a hands-on, you learn, I will help you sort of guy, right? Great, great like mentorship model. Except I didn't want to be mentored, I just wanted a shoffice, right? So anyways, he's teaching me how to become a carpenter. That's fine, we're all a little bit more like Jesus because of it. And he would say, what do you want? And I'm like, I don't know, just a nice wall here. How tall do you want it? 8 feet sounds good. We have 8 feet board. Do they sell 6-foot boards? No, okay, let's make it 8 feet, right? I had no idea. So we would finish a phase, and he would do this. He'd walk around, and he'd go, did you see the picture of me and Bob working on it? Check this picture out. Here's us. There it is. That's before you add, like, a 4-foot, like, pointy roof on the top. So, and Bob, he's, like, over 6 feet tall, so you can see how high it is sticking up in the air. He'd walk around, and he'd go, He'd look at it, and I'd be watching him. He's not a verbal processor. He's very much an internal processor. So we'd work for like 30, 45, 90 minutes, and he's not saying a word. He's just looking at stuff going, I'm like, is it wrong? I'm looking at my crayon drawing. I'm like, that's pretty close, I think, right? Like, he'd go, we'd finish it, and he'd go, you know what? This would have been a lot easier if we would have just da-da-da-da-da-da-da. I'm like, well, that's good to know, you know? Next time, maybe tell me that before we do that. He'd go, That would have been a lot easier if we would have just done this instead. Like, it was constantly, like, we did something totally wrong, and he'd go, That would have been a lot easier if we would have just done whatever. So we finished the shoffice, but it was to know, it was just completely to Bob's credit. And here's what really struck me the whole time we built it. The whole time we built it, I was a mess, right? I'm running in and out of the house watching YouTube videos. Bob knows what he's doing. He's being patient with me. I have all the wrong tools. We didn't have a nail gun. I didn't realize people built stuff with nail guns. We pounded every stinking nail in that whole thing with a hammer. My arm is like I was like a weird looking Hulk. I was like limping to the side. My forearm was just swollen. My fingers were all beaten up because I don't know what I'm doing. I'm smacking my fingers to pieces, right? I was a mess at the end of it. And my attitude went from like, yay, shoffice, to like, ugh. Like shoffice was like a new like bad word in our house to shout out, you know, shoffice, you know. So my attitude was just going down and down and down. And I'm like, oh, this should take us, I don't know, we could finish it in a couple hours. No, it was like a week-long project, and Bob came, and he helped me through every single step of that project, and we finished it, and the whole time, my attitude was getting worse and worse and worse, and Bria was so generous and graceful. She's like, you guys going to be done today? You going to be done today? Are you guys going to be done today? And I'm like, I'm calling the office. I'm like, I need to take another day off. I need to take another week off. Like, this is not going to happen. Like, we have to finish it, but every single 2x4, every single sheet of plywood, every little bit and piece that took to build the shoffice, Bob was constantly in prayer the entire time. Now, he may have been praying for my soul or my salvation or my safety or something, but he really built that entire shed as an act of worship. And I've never known someone You hear the verse, pray continually, pray without ceasing, right? Pray all the time. Bob prays all the time. He prayed through every step of us building that shed. And what was the most unspiritual experience of like my summer was building this shed. It was like the most edifying thing. And I'm sitting there with Bob, and I'm frustrated, and we're doing stuff wrong. We have to pull these things apart, and we have to redo the whole thing. We have to go to Home Depot and spend more money again. I'm like, what in the world? You know, I should have just bought a tarp and like some sticks, right? I should have done anything but this. Like, it's too late now. He was worshiping God the whole time. And at first, I thought it was just, you know, because he's a pastor, he's in ministry, and he loves people. And I thought, oh, that's kind of neat. Bob's always praying. But then the second day we were still working, he's praying. And he's just talking to Jesus, you know. It freaked me out sometimes because I think he's talking to me. And I'm like, oh, no. But he was praying out loud. He was just constantly praying. And I saw something quite literally I hadn't seen before. And I saw somebody living a life of worship in a situation that seemed pretty unspiritual to me. I mean, we're just working out of a garage with inadequate tools, inadequate supplies, an inadequate plan. And yet in the midst of it, Bob was just generous and gracious the whole time. And he was praying constantly the whole time. I had never seen that in somebody before. And I realized his connection with Jesus wasn't just in his ministry life. It extended so deeply into his relationship and his identity and who he was. It even, like, impacted the way he built sheds with his clumsy son-in-law, right? Bob has a relationship, a connection with Jesus that in the moments when we were building that shed, I was really in awe and blown away. And it really challenged me. We stay connected through Christ in a variety of ways. What are some things you do? What do we do to stay connected to Christ? We read our Bibles. What else do we do? Shout it out. What else do we do to stay connected to Jesus? We do worship. What else? Pray. Yeah, we do lots of things, right? We have devotions, right, that may include a different thing. We fellowship. We get together. We have friends. You know, we do a lot of things to stay connected with Jesus. And there's a lot of people who would be really eager to help you and to stay connected with Jesus in many ways. But we struggle to fit all of these things in when our lives become too busy. Do you keep a spiritual checklist? Have you ever done this before? Where you feel you go to maybe a conference like this, or you have an event or a message, you get really convicted, and you say, oh, here's what I need to do. I need to write down. I need to do X, Y, and Z every day. I need to do A every month. Every other month, every quarter, I'm going to do B. Once a year, we're going to do C. And you map out this great framework of spiritual formation. And now you have this great checklist. And you rest and you think to yourself, oh, finally, I'm going to be connected to Jesus. I got a roadmap right in front of me, right? And then you go about your day and you don't get X, Y, and Z. You miss Y that day and you feel a little bit bad. And a week later, you're barely hanging on to X, right? The bi-weekly, whatever passes and you've missed A. The quarter passes, you've not done B. And your annual C is out the window, right? You're barely hanging on to any of your plan. And a lot of times, we try to remain connected by just keeping a series of tasks in front of us. But when our spiritual checklist goes unmarked, we feel like failures. Who here has ever started to read the Bible through the year plan, right? Good luck. Now, those of you who have done it, it's amazing, right? I've started many. I have finished none, okay? Every January, I'm like, you know what would be great? You know what would be great this year? Let's read the Bible in a year. I think it'd be a good goal to read a Bible in a year plan in a year, right? Like, if I can wrap my brain around if I just read the references, I feel blessed maybe. If I can do that for a year, I'll use that as a year. Next year, maybe I'll step up and read the headers to the thing. I don't know what it is. My wife and I, we listened to the Bible reading in the year. Anyone ever listened to the Daily Audio Bible podcast? It's a great podcast. Is Brian, is that the host? He's great, but he starts each episode like this. First off, okay, so he reads the Bible, but he starts with like 10 minutes of introduction, right? And he has like this support group of people. So he always has some like music in the background. So it's like a babbling brook or like willows in the wind or like animals cooing in the back. It's always very distracting. Like, it's supposed to add environment to it, but it sounds like he's in some sort of stormy zoo all the time, right? And then he starts out, this is the Daily Audio Bible. Like, he has this really
distract them. Today we're reading from Ezekiel.
And like he has this, and he pauses. I'm like, spit it out, man. Just read the Bible, right?
Today we have a prayer list from, and in the back there's like, coo, 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 from.
He had dolphins one time. I'm like, who reads around dolphins, right? Like, I get the animals and the birds and like the starry sky, whatever that sounds like, but dolphin, like it's so distracting. But for a year, my wife and I, we were with Brian in the Daily Audio Bible. It's a great ministry. We were totally blessed by it, but it was so distracting. And it's so hard because we would be in days where I'm like, oh, I'm like 3 weeks behind and I have to catch up with all this Brian from Daily Audio Bible. What sort of zoo will we be visiting this week? Like, how is Nancy in Tuscaloosa doing with her prayer request? Like, we had to sit through all the stuff, right? And I'd fast forward, and skip through halfway through. I'm like, ah, it's Leviticus, whatever. Let's just keep rolling anyways. Like, it was hard. And it's because what I was trying to do is maintain some sort of spiritual checklist with Jesus. I know it's good for me, and I know I just have to choose it. It's a discipline, right? We have to make the choice to do it. But I found that my devotional life and my worship life became more about Jesus than being with Jesus. When I was a children's pastor for the very first time, I realized something that had never occurred to me before. And that is, I was with the kids all Sunday, every Sunday. And one of the most meaningful connections that I have with Jesus is in worship. And I remember the first year went by that we were children's pastors, and I had this thing hit me, and I realized I have not sat through an entire worship service without interruption this whole year. I think this event, Fusion, was the only time in a whole year that I got to sit through a service and just worship. And I realized, like, I got convicted. I'm like, man, like, why do I feel so anxious spiritually? Why do I feel like such a kind of a loot? Like, I'm not connecting with Jesus how I want to. And I realized I hadn't just been worshiping Jesus. And, you know, of course I had in bits and pieces, but I hadn't just really just been able to just give myself away to just worshiping him. And it was at that time I had to rediscover how to worship Jesus. I had to reinvent some ways for me in my life to reengage that part of my Christian life. I had to find other ways to worship. And a lot of times as we grow and things change and our responsibilities shift and our schedules develop and maybe you have kids, maybe you're getting married, maybe you're in school, maybe you have grandkids, our life changes. But when our spiritual life goes unexamined, we don't adjust our life to being with Jesus. A lot of times we'll realize it after the fact, and we'll kind of like tag some stuff at the end to try to plug up the gaps, right? Like a sinking ship, and we're trying to like patch it together. Oh, I'm going to buy a new Bible reading plan. Psh, you know, there. Oh, you know, I'm going to buy this worship CD. Or I'm going to, every day I'm going to open with prayer. Psh, you know, oh, I'm going to write Bible verses on post-it notes and stick it on my mirror in the morning. Psh, you know, we try to do all this sort of stuff. And when the Bible goes unread, the prayers go unprayed, and the songs go unsung, we feel like spiritual failures. And Jesus doesn't want to live out our relationship with him like that. Jesus doesn't want our ministries, he doesn't want our spiritual lives to be about him. He wants our ministries and our spiritual lives to be lived with him. And there's a profound difference between the two. Our connection with Christ isn't just about maintaining a series of tasks. Think about it as this, like points on a page. And we kind of create our own patterns in life depending on our own points on a page. I want you to grab a piece of paper and a pen. I want you to do this. Make a point on that page, and I want you to write something that you do, okay? This is one of the many checklists, one of the things that you have to take care of. Write a dot. I wrote mine. I have to submit my receipts, all right? Every month I got to submit my receipts. Here's a few of them. I scan this page. Date night. That's something on my checklist that goes unchecked way too often, right? Date night, what else? Kids' homework. My daughter's in first grade now. We have to help her with homework. It takes a lot of time to help a first grader read a few pages out of a book. Service project, right? Write a few of these down. Write a few down. Put a few dots on this. This represents your life. These are things that you do, things that you visit. I took this and I kind of filled out some more. This is what it looks like. These are things just off the top of my head. These are more dots in my life. You can't see it. We have a thing up there. There we have, I got to submit my budget for 2017. I got the receipts, staff meetings, review job descriptions, my prayer, worship, missions giving. I got to grade papers. I have homework to do. Spring enrollment is on, like, due now. Small groups, special events, service pride date, vacation, yard work, good luck, homework. Like, I got a lot going, right? And all of our lives look like this, don't they? Your life looks like this. If you spend enough time, and I don't want to stress you out or anything, but you put a lot of dots down. You are a busy people. And all the technology, all the conveniences of life, they haven't made life more simple for us. They've just enabled us to be busier and to do more things. You know, all these inventions, all these tools that we have to make life more simple and streamlined, they make us more productive, but do we self-regulate and say, stop, that's enough? No, instead of doing 10 things a day, we start doing 100 things a day, right? Instead of responding to 10 phone calls a day or texts, but like we're constantly getting stuff done, and it feels good. In fact, it's almost a little bit addictive. And some of us, we live off the high of checking off a checklist. Be honest in here. Who's a checklist person? Come on. I know. I feel you. I was never a checklist person. I also never got much done. Then I started making checklists, right? It's amazing. And there's nothing like just crossing something off that list. I'll savor it. Now, I know you've done this before. Have you ever finished something that wasn't on your checklist? What do you do? You write it down so you can cross it off. That, you have a problem if that's what you're doing, right? Sometimes I'll make stuff up. I'm like, cross off the thing on the checklist. I'm like, crossing it off, right? Like, we have a problem, right? But it feels good to get stuff done. And when we map out our whole life, we realize that we have a lot going on. We probably have too much going on. We have all these points and all these connections. And next to washing the dishes and doing the homework, what becomes the next thing on the checklist? Pray. And what becomes the thing after that? Read your Bible. What becomes the give to missions? What becomes after that? We start integrating our task-oriented life with our spiritual-oriented life. And for so many of us, it's the only way we know how to live a life that's about Jesus. But what happens is we start creating little patterns of life. We have areas of life, and we tend to those areas. And despite what we think, we're not very good at multitasking, right? And so we enter an area of life, and we get in that zone. And maybe this is just me, but I think you would identify with it. Where when we're at home, we're in the home zone, right? Okay, what do we got to do? You have your little circuit you run around the house. We'll wash the dishes. We'll fold the laundry. We'll clean the bathrooms. By the time the bathrooms are clean, you know what you got to do? You got to wash the dishes. Then you got to fold the laundry. Then you feed people somewhere in between, right? You just got to keep the house functioning. And we have our little home life. And we run around our home life, and we have our check marks. And then when we get to church, what do we do? Okay, we're at church. What do we at church? Well, we got to attend on every Sunday. We got to do something about the midweek program. We need to be involved in some sort of small group, and we have to, there's this missions project coming up. Oh, there's the missions giving thing. Ah, there's the Christmas drive. And so we get in church zone, and where does our mind go? It goes to church, and we live in the church world for a little bit, right? Then if you're in school, like me, you go to school, you're like, okay, what do we have to do with school? Well, we have to do this assignment. We have to read this book. We have to fill out that form. We have to do this thing. And then we live in school world. And our life becomes a series of moving between, okay, home world, okay, this is good, things are going here, it's like you're spinning a plate, right? Home world, okay, ready, and switch. School world, okay, go and switch. Then we go run back to the next thing. Okay, we're at church. Okay, switch, okay, back to home real quick. Oh, no, back, and we do this, and it's exhausting. And then in the middle of all that, we're supposed to maintain some sort of relationship with Jesus, and how do we treat it? We run over to Jesus world. Look at that. Then we go, okay, I got to do my devotionals. I got to pray. I got to worship. And I got to do missions giving. Okay, switch. And we keep spinning these plates. And we run back and forth and back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. And when something falls and crashes, we feel horrible. And it's exhausting. That approach to life, it's like we're living our life about Jesus and not with Jesus. When something's going poorly, we just spend more time there and try to improve it, right? We recruit specialists. We buy a book. We listen to a podcast. We get a fitness coach, right? We get an organization book. We buy Getting Things Done. We read How to Improve Your Spiritual Life in 5 Easy Steps, right? We do. We specialize in making this better, right? So we focus on it. And though we know that some other plates are going to drop and some other tasks are going to go undone, we realize this is important, so we have to do it. And we treat our spiritual life in the same way. But we have to ask ourselves the question, what does this look like to really, truly stay connected to Jesus? If you have your Bible, I want you to open up to John chapter 15. We're going to read a passage I know you're familiar with, but it speaks to this point directly. And if your Bible has little headings in it, you'll see above John 15, it says, Jesus, the true vine. Now, this is Jesus talking to his students, his disciples, right? He is preaching and teaching to people. He's explaining God's truth to these individuals. And he, unlike anyone else, uses a very practical, beautiful word picture to explain what it's like to stay connected to Jesus. And we're going to read it this morning. So if you have your Bible, I'm reading out of, I think, New Living Translation. And I'm going to start at just chapter 15, verse 1. It starts like this. This is Jesus. I am the true grapevine, and my Father is the gardener. All right, you tracking with Jesus? Grapevine, gardener, check. He cuts off every branch of mine that does not produce fruit, and he prunes the branches that do bear fruit, so they will produce even more fruit. You have already been pruned and purified by the message I have given you. Verse 4, remain in me, and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit itself if it is severed from the vine, and you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. All right, vine, whoosh, branches sticking out of the vine. God's the gardener, right? He's pruning, he's trimming. We see here the only way for us to bear fruit is to remain in Christ. We can't do it alone. We can't do it apart from him. In fact, if we're a vine, if we're a branch sticking off the vine and we're bearing no fruit, it's not looking good for us, right? Because the gardener's in the garden. And I'm not a gardener, but I understand if you have a plant whose purpose is to bear fruit and a branch isn't bearing fruit, what happens to that branch? It's gone. And we pick up with Jesus in verse 5. Yes, I, the vine, you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Ouch, Jesus. Okay. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. But if you remain in me and my words remain in you, you may ask for anything you want and it'll be granted. When you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples. This brings great glory to the Father. True disciples. To be called a true disciple, a true follower of Jesus. Like, how badly would you in that crowd want to be considered a true follower of Jesus? Surely there were people gathered around Jesus who were curious, right? People who may have just been attracted to the crowd. People who really didn't know what Jesus was about or were interested in it but not sold out. But would you want to be called one of those people who was a true disciple? I know I would. So what does it take to remain in him, to become a true disciple, to realize that when we are obedient, that there's evidence of our obedience, this fruit. And our purpose is not just to exist next to Jesus, but to bear fruit for the sake of Jesus. He says, I have loved you even as the Father loved me. Remain in my love. When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love, just as I obey the Father's commandments and remain in his love. I've told you these things so that you'll be filled with my joy. Yes, that your joy would overflow. This is my commandment, right? This is how you bear fruit. This is what it is. He says, love each other in the same way I have loved you. There's no greater love than to lay down one's life for your friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you slaves because a master doesn't confide in his slaves. Now, you are my friends, since I have told you everything the Father told me. You didn't choose me, I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit, so the Father will give me whatever you ask for, using my name. This is my commandment, Jesus says. Love one another. The fruit that grows on the vine are connected to Jesus. And that fruit, that evidence of our connection, that sign that makes us a true disciple, an obedient follower of Jesus, is that we're loving other people. That is what happens when we learn how to be with Jesus and not just be about Jesus. It's true discipleship. It's such an interesting picture that he paints there of God loving Jesus and Jesus loving us. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, us having the ability to love other people. And through our love of others, it says it's a spiritual act of worship unto God. Our love of God gets reflected back to where the whole thing started, our love of God and our love of Jesus and Jesus loving us and the Holy Spirit giving us power to love Jesus. And that very act of love is an expression of our love for God, right where the whole thing started. We are part of this unbreakable chain, this connection of love. And everything that we do should be connected to this love. Because a lot of times when we're working in our churches, it feels a lot like we're building a shed. We know the boards, we know the nails, we know the hammers, right? And we can name each little kid that's like a knot in that wood. That no matter how hard you pound that nail, it's just not going to do what you want. Not that you hit your kids, but no matter how hard you pound that nail, it's not going to do what you want it to do. And we know how frustrating it is. And you know what? Sometimes we treat our jobs like we're professionals, don't we? And we have a business to do. And what's our business about? Our business is about Jesus. And we maintain some sort of ministry checklist. But I'll tell you, just like your spiritual life can feel disappointing or frustrating or like a failure when you're living about Jesus instead of with Jesus, your ministry can feel the exact same way. I'm going to invite the band to come up because we're going to take a moment and pause and just think about this tonight. This concept of living with Jesus, of being connected with Jesus, is a really important one. And I think a lot of us go through a lot of heartache because our lives, they're not really being lived with Jesus, it's about Jesus. And it's because we're building a shed like I built a shed, right? We're building a shed. We don't know what's going on, but we're trying really, really hard. We couldn't work any harder. We have all the right pieces. We know. We watch the YouTube videos. We know these are the elements, right? They're laying in a pile in the corner. And we work with them, and we're frustrated with them, and they're challenging us, and we're not getting where we want to go. And we feel like, oh, God, this shed should be built by now. I'm doing exactly what I was told to do. Why isn't it working? When the purpose is not just to accomplish a task, it's to live in that community, in that relationship with God. Our identity is not found in all the things that we can check off on a list. God's not keeping a scorecard with you saying, oh, check, Bible read today, check. Ooh, didn't do Old Testament and New Testament, but we'll still give him a check. All right, what else do we do? Prayed today, check. Lunch, breakfast, dinner, we'll count that today, right? Like, God's not like writing down, keeping track of all the things we're doing. He's not keeping a scorecard like that. There's a portion of scripture where Jesus describes people are going to approach God and be like, hey, we're in. We're here. Do you know us? And God's like, I don't even know who you are. People who were working really hard for Jesus can still be strangers to Jesus. You know, in preparing for this, I kind of had to check my own heart, right? Like, who am I loving? Like, is there fruit on my vine? Am I loving other people? Because I'm so busy doing work about him, I kind of get in the Jesus industry, right? Monday, I go to the church. Tuesday, I go to the church. Wednesday, I go to the church. What do I do on the weekend? I go to the church. How do I hang out with my friends? Through the church. What are my special hangout times? Church. I have a birthday party. Who comes over? The church, right? Like, it's all, we live in this little world. And it becomes about that, and it becomes about that, and it becomes about that, and it becomes about that. But just like when I was a children's pastor for the first time and I realized I need to rediscover how to worship, some of us need to rediscover how to love people. Because when our work becomes just about them, instead of being with them, they miss the connection between us and Christ. Just like when our work becomes about Jesus instead of with Jesus, we miss that connection. God doesn't call us to work for him. He calls us to be with him. And there's no amount of tasks that you can accomplish to come into community with Jesus. Tonight I have just three simple questions, and I want you to think about them. First one is this. What relationships in your life are evidence of the fruit of your connectedness to Jesus? Jesus said, if you love him, you're going to be loving other people. Okay, who are those people? If this is our fruit, if this is how we show, if this is what determines whether or not we get cut off and thrown into the fire, who are we loving? Or are we just working for a boss and for some volunteers and for some families? There's a lot to do. I mean, you saw my checklist. There's a lot to do. But is it just spinning plates? Or are you truly investing yourself into someone? Rebecca did a beautiful job describing what that looks like today, staying connected to people. Because just as needy and ornery and as annoying those people are, they bug us because we realize we're them, right? That's us. And is our identity caught up in the past? Is it caught up in our previous experiences? Or have we reformed our identity with God and how he made us? Like Al described last night. Guys, our identity is in him. It's not in the stuff that's happened to us. And it's not despite of us. God uses all that we've brought to the table, all the mess, and he redeems it and points it right back to reflect upon him and his grace and his goodness in our life. What relationships are evidence of the fruit in your life right now? Here's a second question. What area of your life is currently disconnected from Jesus? Do you have the ability, like Bob did, to praise Jesus while you're building a shed, while you're making the 100th trip to Home Depot, when you're putting gas in the truck again? Can you praise Jesus in those moments? Are the most insignificant parts of your day something that can bring glory to God? And third, are you just doing ministry about Jesus instead of with Jesus? We're busy. You guys are busy. I know it. You're as busy, if not busier, than any single person in your entire church. You and the worship person, you show up first and you leave last. You work with the largest group of volunteers in your entire ministry. Your people that you minister to are the only people in the entire church that cannot advocate for themselves. They are 100% dependent on you and your team to provide for them, to help them go to the bathroom, for crying out loud. These kids are dependent on you. And it keeps you really busy. But have you let that busyness come in place of relationship with God and how he made you? So here's what we're going to do. Sean and the team, they're going to lead us in a song. And I want you to think about these three things. And when we're done, I'm going to ask you to respond. And we're just going to stand up right where we're at. I'll probably ask you to come forward. And I want you to pray, and I want you to ask God and just recommit yourself to doing ministry with Jesus, to loving people again, to being all about him again, that God would restore your ability to worship him in the middle of it all, in all your busyness, that your areas of life could merge into one. And you would realize that we would realize once again, our life is not just a series of tasks, and that Jesus is another set of tasks or plates that we got to keep spinning, but that he is the engine that drives us to spin all those plates in the first place. So as we sing the song, I want you to think about that. And in a moment, I'm going to call you to respond and simply to come forward and recommit yourself to living that way.